So I just wanted to come on right quick. First, I just wanted to give you guys an update on the book. I didn't get when I did the announcement, I didn't really go that much into detail about everything. So I just wanted to talk a little bit about that just in case anybody was interested. So back in June, so it's been about a month. I started looking at publishing, so trying to look into the difference between self-publishing and all that kind of stuff. And had I really gone the full self-publishing route, the book probably could have been out by now. But I decided to go with Lynn Cross Publishing. And if you guys aren't familiar with them, that's Heather Lindsay and Cornelius Lindsay. They have a publishing company, right? And so right around the time I was looking around that, they opened up their applications. So, because they do theirs in cycles. And so they opened up the applications. I was like, well, this is cool timing. And I, been following their ministry for a while. And I was really, they have a whole lot of books. They've published quite a few books over the years. And so I was like, this is someone I can, felt pretty comfortable with. I, looked at all their stuff, all their information. I was like, yeah, I'm pretty cool with this. And so the thing about Lynn Cross is they do not print the book for you. Because they don't print the book for you, they don't take any royalties. So I thought that was really awesome. When you start looking into publishing books and selling books, if you're going through a publisher or if you're going through Amazon or whatever, basically they'll take royalties. So they'll take a percentage of your book, the sales. They'll take part of that basically. And it's not anything uncommon. It's not anything oh no, beware of. But it's kind of like the industry. But Heather and Lizzie, their publishing company, they actually don't take any of the royalties. And part of that is because they don't print your book. So you have to find somewhere else to print the book, right? But that's not a big deal. I found a couple places that I could print the book, right? So anyways, that's where I am. So right now I'm in the process of says they're editing the book right now. Now I don't feel like it should take that long. The book isn't really long at all. The thing is it's I know sometimes if you're a writer, particularly if you're a writer, you might have a pressure to get a certain word count, particularly if you're publishing with a publisher, a big name publisher. I think they have a 35,000 word count minimum or something like that. Don't have me lying, I don't really know. But typically books are pretty 35,000 words. That's a typical stance. So this book right here, this size of a book is probably about 35,000 words. My rough estimate on that, right? And so my book is nowhere near that long because my thing was if you're out here, the whole thing is it's for deliverance. It's so that you can be delivered. So if you're something that's something you're seeking after, you're trying to figure out how you can pray so you're delivered from wherever it is you need to be delivered from. You don't need a long chapter book to figure that out. You don't want that because it's gonna take you a while to get through it. I needed something that is really quick. So you hear my testimony so that it kind of increases your faith, and then then we go through the actual steps of you going through deliverance. That's basically what the book is. So it gets really straight to the point. I just had it to have it long enough so I can tell my full story. So then people actually understand, okay, this is where she was and this is where she is now. Kind of like building your faith, same thing we're doing for all these videos, right? So anyway, that's where the book is. So we're in editing right now. And so they say it could take 3 months to edit or whatever, just because they have they do like a big group of books at one time, I think. And I think they have a smaller team. But yeah, it'll probably still be the but we're right now still right on track. So the book will be probably done around October and it'll probably release it around November. That's what my plan is so far. So I'm really excited about that. So, and in the same vein of the whole deliverance, it's crazy how I've gone through deliverance when it came to anxiety. That's literally what the book is about, right? But the thing is, the same tools, the same steps I went through to get delivered from anxiety, I can use to get delivered from anything else. And I don't know why it didn't dawn on me earlier. So this morning I was praying, and one of the things this past weekend, God kind of was highlighting a lot of things. I told you guys I went on this trip. I went to a conference, and basically the Holy Spirit was really speaking quite loudly to me. And telling me a list of things to work on, things to research, to look more into, all this kind of stuff. And one of the things was, I have a mentor. I told you guys about this. And one thing is when we first met, part of our second meeting, our second time spending time together, she told me you have on this thing of avoidance. So she was at first she thought it was the spirit of rejection, but she was no, that's not it. It's for you, it's avoidance. Spirit of rejection is something that's pretty I don't want to say common, but it's something I've heard of before. But then she said it's not that, it's avoidance. I was like, I don't exactly know what that means. Like, that's nothing, not something I thought I've ever thought of, not anything I've ever considered. And basically, she was basically saying, like, and like, I get it now that she highlighted it. So, like, for me, it'll be like, particularly mostly in conversations when I had to talk to someone about a certain thing, like, if I was afraid of their response or if I didn't know how they would respond, I would avoid the conversation completely. If I knew how they would respond and I didn't want to go through that, so like if I knew they were going to be mad about it or whatever, I would just avoid the whole conversation, right? That's something like has been a pattern for a really long time, right? And she was like, yeah, that's a thing. And mind you, she at that point just met me, like the Holy Spirit just kind of gave it to her, like pointed out, like, yeah, that's something. And like the crazy thing is, the third part of this thing says be appalled. My pastor did a message about a month or so ago about being appalled. And basically, you know about Paul, he wrote a lot of the New Testament. I think he wrote 2/3 of the New Testament. And so like Paul, you know, he started all these churches, but then he also wrote to the churches when he ever, like there was like issues going on. So when there was something going on, like with the church, like he would write them a letter and tell them, hey, these are things like these, this is what you're doing good right now. This is what you need to work on right now. And so he like would tell them. And so, like, the whole thing is, like, be a Paul or have a Paul. Like, so, like, my mentor is literally, like, my Paul. She literally can point out things that I don't even recognize, that I don't even see myself, and she can tell me. So then that way, like, bring that light to it allows me to then work on those type of things, right? And so, like, literally that's what my pastor's message was about. Like, you know, you need to have people around you, people who surround you who can tell you those things, who can tell you, hey, this is, like, this is something I noticed that you do. Maybe you should work on it, you know? And then... yeah. And then on the other side of that is you have to be receptive of what they say. So like a lot of times it's like it's easy to like catch an attitude or get like really defensive, you know, like someone tells you, hey, yeah, you have a bad attitude. It's really get defensive if somebody tells you that or anything they might possibly say to you that's negative. It's easy to be like defensive. But the thing is you have to be open. You have to be receptive to what they're saying. Because the thing is, and this is why it's kind of important to be careful who's around you, like be make sure you're like, what's the word? Intentional about the people who you keep around you, particularly the people who are close to you. So like, if you like, make sure you have to be intentional about who you're surrounded by, like who have close access to you, because you want people who love you, who want nothing but the best for you, who don't really want to take anything from you, but want to see you grow and genuinely care about you. So then those people, when they tell you like, hey, yo, you might want to work on that, then those are people you can then trust, because you know it's coming out of love. You know it's coming from them wanting you to be better. And so the thing is, it's like you have to be receptive to that, those critiques, so then that way you can grow. And the thing is also on the flip side of that, sometimes you may be required to be that pawn for someone else. And I feel like that very strongly for where I am right now. There's like a couple people I feel like that, because I have access to them and I can see sides of them that, you know, necessarily other people may not see, or like it might be, I might be closer to them than maybe other people. So then because I have that access, then it's almost like my responsibility to say something. And it's kind of like a daunting task almost. And this was me still with the whole avoidance things, because I didn't like uncomfortable conversations. Like I just like, I'm not gonna say nothing. Like, and that's literally go months without having no conversation, right? And so like, but the thing is I'm responsible. Like literally if God has allowed me to have this access to be this intimate with a person, and that means I'm responsible to help them grow, you know? Because the thing is, it's like if I say I care about my friends or my family members, like I can't just have them out here struggling or looking crazy, you know? I have to like say something. And so I think now it's like, okay, I really feel like, all right, I can now do that. I can now walk into that. I literally got delivered from the whole avoidance thing this morning. Like, this is fresh. So I'm really excited about that. But I literally just prayed about it. I just asked God to release me of it so I won't be bound by it. Because the thing was, it was like you're almost living through the situation longer than you have to be, almost twice as long than you have to be. Because the thing is, I would think about it and like, oh no, I don't want this. And like all the things I didn't want to, which were the reasons why I didn't want to have the conversation in the first place. But eventually the conversation still has to be had, you know? Or sometimes like the conversation wasn't initiated by me, it's initiated by the other person. And so then in those cases, like of course it's coming, like they just going on about their day. And meanwhile, I'm sitting here anxious. Let me tell you how this happened one time, right? So my pastor had called, like texted me, it was like, hey, let's have a meeting. And for some reason, I have no idea why. I was like, I must have done something. Like, literally, that's my first thought. And so this was, like, he had texted me, like, a Tuesday or a Wednesday, right? And the meeting was set for, like, Friday. And so I was legit sitting there, like, oh, my God, I really don't want this. Because for some reason, the thing is, I hadn't done anything. Like, I'm not, you know, out here reckless, doing crazy stuff, talking to the members crazy or spending money like crazy. I hadn't done anything. Like, everything was chill. But for some reason, it was, like, irrational. I had this irrational fear that I had done something wrong. And I did not want to have one of those conversations with my pastor. So I was like, oh, I was dreading it. And so then I text them. So mind you, I could easily just ask, hey, what's the meeting about? But because I didn't want to go into it, I just was like, let me just avoid this whole situation. And so then I think it was like Friday afternoon. I got off work a little bit early. So I was like, well, maybe let me first see if he wants to talk. Maybe, like, does he still even want to talk? So I was like, maybe at this point he doesn't care anymore, because I'm still thinking I did something wrong, right? So, y'all, he doesn't care anymore. So I just asked. And I was like, or maybe he'll want to talk earlier. And I texted him. I was like, hey, did you still want to talk? He's like, yep. 7 o'clock. And I was like, ugh. That was like hours from then. So I was just sitting there like, ugh. And so anyway, this was when we were back at the school. We were renting out the school. Now we have our own building. So I get to the school. He's like, hey, let's have this meeting. And so he's talking. And like throughout the entire meeting, or at least the first half of that meeting, I'm still like, he's saying all these good things. Like, oh, I see this. I see you growing this area and this. And this is what I see for you. And this is what's coming up. But I'm still waiting for the but in that whole situation. So but, and then the whole you did this, this, and this, or whatever, whatever. And I couldn't properly receive from him what he was saying at first because, he was probably like, what's wrong with this girl? Like, because I was just sitting there just like, ugh. And then I'll finally say, and then, like, he was like, all right, so what do you think? He saw super excited. I'm just like, you know, all this time I thought I was in trouble. And he was like, wait, what? Yeah. I was like, literally this whole week I thought I did something. And he's like, well, why didn't you ask? And I was just like, here's that whole avoidance thing. But I couldn't tell him about that because I was avoiding that as well. You see how crazy that is? Like, first of all, the cycle that creates, like, I couldn't tell you about this because I'm avoiding this, and I'm also avoiding telling you about the avoidance thing, so I can't tell you, I can't even rationalize it. Like, it's just crazy. Like, it's like, you went through all that, and it ended up being a good conversation, and, like, I went through unnecessary turmoil because of the fact that I was avoiding having conversations. And so, like, that kind of definitely, once my mentor, like, highlighted it to me, like, she highlighted that thing, like, it was like, we met around October, November or so. So, and that conversation with my pastor happened actually like February or March or something. So mind you, I was aware of the thing, but I hadn't done the steps to actually say, okay, but how do I stop doing this? How do I change? How do I rework the way I think? And so like the thing is like one of the things I've learned that I see kind of often is like, we'll be aware of a situation or aware of something that we need to work on, but then we stop there. And so I know I have one of my family members is like, I wanted to talk to them about a certain thing, but I know how they respond. And I know their response is, yeah, I know. So they're aware of the thing, but they never go beyond that. And so I was avoiding having conversations with them because I was like, I already know what they're going to say. And like, how crazy is that? So literally we're both stuck now. I'm sitting here with this burden to help this person, and they're sitting there stuck in this thing that they're been in, and neither one of us is communicating, neither one of us is grown from it. And it's just like, when someone, like, I think particularly when it comes to people you're close with, it's like this constant reminder of, like, you have to be open to what they say, because the thing is, God placed you in their lives for a reason. And, like, God has connected me to people for a reason. So that we're just not here just to be friends and be cool. But it's like, no, like, iron sharpens iron. So, like, let's go. Let's get this thing. Like, yeah, we can be cool, hang out, friends. But then also when I see you lacking in something, or if you see me lacking in something, like, let's communicate. Let's talk about this. And, like, yeah, I might be a little salty. But now, actually, no, I'm not going to be. Because now I recognize, like, okay, no, this is a moment that I need just to work on something and just be cool with it. And so now it's just like, all right. Even if the conversation does turn to, all right, you need to work on this, 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 and this, it's like, all right, because I know where you're coming from. Whew. So, I said all that to say the book is going well. It's effective. It works. I got delivered this morning. Actually, I got delivered from pride and avoidance, because I had an issue with pride to a point where, like, I legit wouldn't go to the altar on Sunday. And it was just no reason. Like, I felt God telling me to go, and I was just like, and, like, for no reason, just because of being prideful, you know? And, like, sometimes you care about what everyone else thinks. That has stopped me so often. Like, stopped me from, like, giving somebody a word. Stopped me from praying for somebody. Stopped me from healing somebody because of the fear of what the person might think or how they may respond. And, like, the thing was, is, like, at first I was trying to, like, break fear. So I was like, oh, that's where it's coming from, the fear of this. But, no, that's not the root of it. Literally, the root of it is your pride. Because you don't want to be embarrassed, or you don't want to feel awkward or whatever. And so, like, but amen, we're delivered from that. I'm really excited about that. Literally happened this morning. It wasn't like a long prayer. It was just like in my regular prayer time. I was like, you know what? Why not? And so, yeah, got delivered from pride and avoidance. And it's cool because, like, God literally told me, like, I'm changing the way you think. And I think that's so awesome, right? So, yeah. I was going to encourage you guys. Oh, yeah. So just to encourage you guys. Be open. Be open to when people start telling you, like, hey, or point out to you, like, hey, maybe you should work this. Or did you know that you do this? Did you know that you get really upset when this one particular thing is brought up? Or, hey, have you noticed how you kind of behave in this certain way in this certain situation? When particularly when it's people who you know, who you intentionally placed around you, who you know have your best interests at heart. When they start bringing these things up to you, don't catch your attitude. Don't get defensive. Just like, all right, thank you. And, like, if you feel some type of way about it, take that up with God, and then God can help you sort through those feelings. But, like, don't take it out on the person, because they just trying to help, you know? And so there's that. So surround yourself by good people. Be open to their critiques of you or their when they want to help you or help you grow, moments of growth. Be open to moments of growth. And the book is coming. So, yeah, I will talk to you guys later.